Welcome back guys. Kan hari ini kita nyentok episode 3 sama Why sama Oh My Venus sama MTB Master the Basics. Hi guys.
Hi.
Hello.
Alright, so guys kalau gak tahu itu MTB itu coachnya assistant coach ya, assistant coach right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the assistant coach of kan Blacklist. Kan dia baru menang SEA Games juga kan, SEA Games Qualifier kan, dia coach baru ya guys. Kalau gak tahu kenal dulu. Okay. So, I'm gonna use English now. So normally, we're gonna ask you some questions, sensitive questions as well. Questions from the Indonesian fans. Alright?
Oh, okay.
Okay, and then if there's any questions that you don't want to answer, you know, feel free. But, you know, Indonesians, sometimes, you know, like, they're very toxic sometimes, you know, like, Instagram accounts get deleted, shit like that, you know. Probably the most toxic region in MPL right now, Mobile Legends. Okay. So, I think most of the questions are going to be directed towards Venus and Wise first, and then we're going to ask MTB after that.
Okay.
All right. So for Wise and Venus, you guys recently it was announced that you guys are not going to play MPL season 9.
Mm-hmm.
I think many of the fans are kind of curious, like especially from the Indonesian side, right? Like why you guys choose to stop for that season?
We've been playing MPL since season 4. That's like 3 years now, non-stop. So taking a break after winning the World Championships is the perfect opportunity for us to take a break. Since from the past champions that we've seen from M1 and M2, most of their players didn't take a break, and we've seen what happened to them, burned like how they burned themselves in continuously.
Okay, so mainly just you guys just wanted a break before you continue again. You don't want to like ruin your career in a sense.
Yeah, and also this is a good opportunity to play again on season 10 and maybe defend the M series and play for M4.
Okay, cool. So this is a controversial topic in Indonesia as well. So like there's players, like pro players in Indonesia that doesn't want to play season 9 as well, just because there's no M series. So what's your take on that?
I think MSE is still a good tournament to prove something.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
Like I said, it's actually one of the reason also why we want to take a rest for season 9. So we can have a better mindset going for season 10 and M4.
But so I understand that like last MSC, it was, who was it? Execration that won it, was it?
Yeah, it was Execration.
But don't you guys want to win like MSC, just say that you have won everything, you know, you won MPL, you won M series, yeah. You have won MSC. Isn't that one of your targets?
I think the rest is still priority, is our priority, because we can still get MSC next year.
Okay. So it means that you guys are not gonna plan to retire anytime soon. This is still like a long time career for you guys.
Yeah, it's just a rest. For us, M series is much better. So okay. We better prepare for it.
So I think that's something for Moonton to adjust, you know. Probably they might make it a point system next time, perhaps. Because I understand that a lot of pro players see it the same way. Because M series and one is a world championship, one is just Southeast Asia, right? So different quality. All right.
Sounds like a pretty good idea.
Cool. So like for MTB, like you're the coach right now, right?
So for Seaball, during the qualifiers, I was the coach, but officially it's still coach Bon.
Okay.
I'm still the assistant coach.
So what do you think about this, saying that both Wise and Venus isn't going to play for MPL Season 9? What's your thoughts on this, actually?
I think they already did what they wanted to do, to win those championships last year, from back-to-back championships to M3. I think they deserve to rest. This is really their best time to rest. If they wanted to win M4, they need to be back at for Season 10. If they won't rest for Season 9, they won't be able to rest on Season 10. It won't be, there won't be a break for them if they didn't take this break right now.
Yeah.
Okay. Just curious, who are the guys that's going to replace Venus and Wise for Season 9?
Right now, we have a new player, a 15-year-old jungler. His name is Kevier. Yeah. And the other guy is Esson, the 6-man.
Oh, yeah.
Before, for Season 7 and 8, he is the 6-man.
So, who do you think is better, actually? Let's say if you were just to compare the players right now.
That's not even a question. These guys are the M3 champs.
Okay. Do you think that, let's say if, coming to Season 10, do you see, Venus and Wise, trying to fight for a spot? Or do you think it's, a clear winner? They're going to be the main roster.
Oh, for Season 10.
That's it.
I think Blacklist need to have two teams.
Two teams?
Yeah. I can't answer that right now, but for right now, I think V-Wise is still the best for their roles.
Are you guys scared of getting replaced? Maybe
not really. I'm confident with my skills. Actually, Coach Zays, the new jungler of Blacklist International, main role is assassin. So they really have a different play style of for Wise and the new jungler.
Yeah, I understand. I mean, I guess Wise has a special kind of play style compared to most junglers out there, and it's hard to find someone who plays like him.
Yeah, that's very true. Cool.
Yes, and our new jungler is like Albert.
Yeah, Albert. Yeah.
Albert.
God.
So who is better, Albert or this new guy?
We will see on MSC, I think.
you guys are that confident that Blacklist will qualify without you guys?
I think if they practice well.
Yeah, I'm confident that they still can. And we're still gonna work with them so they can easily adapt.
Okay.
So
you guys are still you guys visit the gaming house, or are you guys still a part of the gaming house?
Right now, we're at our house and
resting.
Resting, and I think we will be back on.
Yeah, after a week or a month, maybe.
So for doing scrims and all, are you guys part of the scrims at all, or just completely gone?
Right now, completely gone.
Okay.
Yeah. But maybe soon we'll help the team.
Cool. So we can see Blacklist, new jungler against Albert. That'll be interesting to see.
Or Persic.
Sure. Who's actually, I want to ask, who do you feel is better, Persic or Albert? No bias, because I know back then, I think the netizens from Indonesia, they said that you posted on Instagram story saying that Persic is your idol. So just want to ask you that.
Way back Season 7 in MPLPH, I think Persic is better because he plays Hayabusa and Jisan Shin so well, and other marksman too, like Granger is so good when we're practicing. And then Season 8, Persic is, I think, he's not in good shape.
So Season 8, Persic is not as good as Season 7, right?
Yeah.
Persic
is still my bias because I think he's a good person.
So the real answer is, who's better, Persic or Albert?
Right now, Albert.
Right now, Albert.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So so we can say that Albert is your idol and not Persik anymore.
No, it's still Persik, but I respect Albert too.
Okay, that's interesting. Okay, so I just now actually wanted to ask you this, but I kind of lost track. Oh, I remember now. So like for MSC, right? You said that in MSC that was strong, like that was Persik at top performance, correct?
Yeah.
So I think you guys know that when EVOS played MSC, we didn't have our full roster, right?
Yeah. I think Rek is not in the lineup.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Luminaire.
Yeah, Rek and both Luminaire were not in the lineup.
It was Luminaire.
So I have this sensitive question here. I think we can say that we scream a lot, especially in I think season 7.
Yeah.
All right. So I wanna ask you this, like let's say like in MSC, if we had our full roster and we went against Blacklist and Execration and all, who do you think would have won? Do you think it's gonna be different?
I think we will be in grand finals and we will beat you there.
Oh, so it'll be EVOS and Blacklist, not Blacklist and Execration.
Yeah, because you already beat Execration in upper bracket without Luminaire, and I think that's the same story in lower bracket. But when we meet in grand finals, we will beat you.
Okay.
Yeah, I actually forgot who played for Luminaire in MSC again?
Rexy.
Ah, yeah. I think it will be a different story if Luminaire will play there. Okay. Yeah.
So different story, but you guys still win.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, I'm still waiting for that day to come, you know. Maybe season 10, M4, you know, we really get like the real matchup, you know, where you guys play and we have our full roster too.
Yeah.
That'll be interesting.
I think if it's an offline tournament, it will be different because Indonesia pro player is so hype in offline. They are always shouting.
Was it like this for M3 as well?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like the energy.
You can feel their hype.
Yeah.
When they're playing Mobile Legends.
Was it both RQ and Onyx or just RQ?
Both.
Yeah, playing in offline is different from playing online. Like you can really see their hands shaking when playing offline, so it's really different.
Interesting. So I'm gonna share you guys a story, right? So like in MPL season 8 playoffs for Indonesia, like the team was just in front of each other, right? So we were just shouting nonstop, like during the game, we would just shout like, "Hey, blah, blah, blah," you know, you just keep shouting and shouting. And one of the players was very affected. Like when one of the players from Alter Ego, when they played against RQ, Sin just kept shouting and shouting too. Like the guy just, he just wasn't focused anymore. And like he played bad. He said like it really affected him.
Yeah.
I saw many clips on TikTok. They're shouting at each other.
In offline tournaments, that is where you will see the experience. Yeah.
Is it different in the Philippines?
Yes. Actually, it's almost the same like Indonesia, I think. But with less curse words.
Okay. It's cool. But for what's it? MTB, or is there another way I should address you?
I think that's the easiest way.
Okay, that's the easiest way. So like for MTV, have you been part of any other tournaments besides the SIBO one when you get to go offline?
I usually coach amateur teams before I became part of Blacklist. Oh. So everything was happening offline.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, online, I think. Everything was happening online. So I haven't experienced an offline tournament yet.
So have you seen like someone shouting and all? Not yet?
Not yet.
Okay, yeah. that'll be interesting for you to see. Yeah, but I think like shouting is just kind of like using stickers in game, right? You know, I feel it's the same thing. It's just taunting, but...
Yeah, taunting.
You taunt in-game and you taunt outside the game. You get like double damage, you know?
But for us in Blacklist, when we shout, or maybe Ino said, don't shout, focus. Because we think in Blacklist, shouting in game while in game is affecting our
comms,
our communication. So we shout in the end of the game.
Also, like when you win, then you shout like, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. I think I agree too. I think like when you shout and stuff, you lose this, you lose focus as well, because you kind of forget like what you were supposed to do before.
Yes.
Yeah.
Not just you, but it will also affect your teammates. Mm.
Yes. If you shout in the headset, it's, you can hear also the shouting of your teammate.
Mm, I agree. So
my Venus is there to command us not to shout.
Okay. Okay, catat guys ya. Kalau menurut dia, itu taunting nggak bagus sih guys. Okay, belajar dulu dari M3 champion ya. So yeah, I think there's plus and minus. I think it depends on how each team works. But I think overall both have its valid points.
Yeah, I agree.
Alright, so there's this question here. I don't know if you've seen this, but so like the admin of MPL Indonesia, like he or she is asking, you know, like, have you guys ever thought of playing in MPL Indonesia?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. Me personally, maybe not, because I'm really picky with food, so I think I'm really gonna have a hard time in Indonesia. Maybe even with Wise, maybe two of us will go to Indonesia. I think it will not work. But maybe if there is a chance that the whole Blacklist international team, like all the players, the coach and the analyst will play there. I think that is more interesting, right?
But that wouldn't be a Indonesian team anymore. That would be like just Blacklist migrating to Indonesia, right?
But for me, I think I don't want to play in Indonesia, because I think the jungler in Indonesia requires you to play assassin, and that's just not me.
I think it's not just Indonesia, but I think it's everywhere, just because I think it's just because like Blacklist, your teammates really understand how to play against how to use non-assassins to play against assassins and all. So I think it's just more about like your team really complement together with you and make it really utilize you.
Yeah, every time we're screaming, there is always Lancelot, there is always Lin.
Yeah, even rank games actually, there is Lancelot everywhere.
Yeah, I don't see Baratz and Bane and Aulus.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think because like, you know, rank games, people just want to be flashy, you know. Yeah. And those are like flashier heroes. But what about MTB? Like, have you ever thought of coaching in Indonesia?
I haven't thought about that, but I think the problem will be the communications. Because especially being a coach.
Why coach is in Indonesia? You can do it too.
You can.
If I migrate, if I will be in Indonesia, I need to learn their language, of course, and we'll meet at the middle. They'll have to speak in English, so our chat calls and comms will, everything will be in English, so that will be hard. So that's why I don't think coaching in Indonesia will be hard for us.
I understand, but because I think right now, like, I don't know what you guys think. What do you guys feel about like the coaching scene in Philippines and all? Do you feel like the coaches are at the same level of the like the players, or at the level to coach good players?
Who will answer that?
You.
you can go first. Yeah.
In play style or in mechanical wise, I don't think a coach can be a match to those players unless a coach is also a pro player before. But for me, I wasn't a pro player, so I don't think I can match the mechanical skills of those players. But game knowledge wise, being a coach, that's the most important. Everything that you know in game or outside the game, not just whatever they have to click. So it's an important pack for the coaches. That's more important for us than the mechanical skills.
Okay, I'm kind of curious. So let's say like in Blacklist right now, you guys have two coaches and one analyst.
Yeah.
So yeah. like how do you guys separate the work? Like who does what? Who does this? Who's in charge of what?
Probably the main coach is Coach Bon. He's the one. He's always the one. Along with the team, they are training everything. The analyst is mainly mainly focusing on the
data.
Yeah. Then for me as an assistant coach, my part probably will be. Just a reminder, possibly to remind them if there's something missing or if there's something new, something like that. Because the coach is already focused on the team.
So basically, I can say that how you guys work is like, so you and Bon, it's like you're doing the same kind of the same thing, but the final call is with Bon, and you give like a second opinion.
Yeah, something like that.
Cool. And analyst is Dexter, right?
Yeah.
So Dexter does mainly just data work, like analyzing like the teams and stuff like that.
Yeah, but the good thing here is everyone can really say anything. If they know something, everyone just says it, and if it's possible, if a strategy is something good, even if a player thinks something and we think it will work, we will try it. That's the good thing about Blacklist.
I guess you can say, because I think most of the players in Blacklist are, I'll say that like they are easy to work with, because this is what I look from the outside. Yeah, this is my perspective from the outside. I think you guys don't have that much ego among you, like all the players, so it's very easy to receive feedback and all. That's what how it looks like. Right. I don't know if that's true, but maybe you can confirm with me.
I think as a player, that's true, because we all of us are like family in Blacklist, I think.
Yeah.
Even the new players right now?
Yeah.
For me, the new players, I haven't talked because we're at our house. So
because you guys are different level, you guys are world champions and they are not.
New players from Cibol, Dom and Aul.
Because our team with Cibol team, our side laner Ol and Dominic is purely amateur, right?
Yeah, from amateur.
So we just bonded for 2 weeks and then we became Cibol qualifiers champion.
You guys bonded for 2 weeks and you guys won Cibol qualifiers?
Yeah.
How's are you serious?
Yeah,
that's true.
Duomingo, guys. 2 weeks. Okay, so how do you guys like find like these players? Like where do you get them from?
I think we became champion in Cibol because of our captain. Captain Diff.
Captain who?
Captain Diff.
Ah, okay.
I think 2 weeks was enough for us to become PH representative for the SEA Games, because we we play, me, Haji, and Wise played, and side laners will just, our side laners can easily adjust since our fundamentals really is between me, Wise, and Haji.
Oh yeah, it's a trio, right? The trio chemistry.
Yeah.
But so like example, who is it? Awa and Dominic? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, Awa and Dominic.
Like how did you guys choose them? Like why do you choose them over like every other player out there?
Yeah. It's funny because MTB just posted on
yeah.
On his social media page and then just PM me your
stats.
Your stats, your win rate.
The best heroes, yeah.
And then you found this place?
Yeah. At first, we don't have much time. It's only a 2-week time. So at first we needed to just find or look for players that have good stats. Yeah. And after the stats, they undergo tryouts. Then after a tryout, if they are selected, that's the only time we'll know how they communicate with the players or how their chemistry will work. But with these two, I think the chemistry was good.
What kind of stats do you actually look at? Kind of curious.
Probably from their ranks, highest rank achieved, win rate, best heroes debuts. Possibly that's the only thing we look at.
So the problem with that is that, you know, in Mobile Legends, there's a lot of smurfing, right? A lot of smurfing, a lot of buying of accounts, in English we call it jokey, right? So basically you pay someone to boost, right?
Yeah.
So go on.
That's why, that's why after the stats they undergo tryout. Because if it's a smurfing or a pilot, we call that here pilot. Eh? If it's not you, your playstyle would be different. So we'll know right after the stats. I think we got a lot of tryouts before we pick Dom and all.
So in terms,
actually, we only have 2 days for tryout, and we only tried 2 gold laners and 2 XP. So it's actually just a risk, but I don't know. It just really worked for us. That we got Dominic and Owl.
Yeah.
50-50.
Yeah, it's all about gut feel.
Will you say Dominic and Owl? Do you think like they can be better than Ohep and Edward?
That's actually a hard question. I'm not really sure, but I think they can be at the same level.
Okay.
Maybe after a few more tournaments.
So do you think like the gap is not that far from Ohep and Edward?
Right now the gap is really there, but I believe that they can get there.
Yeah. When we play in Cebol qualifiers versus Ven in our first game, I think their hands is shaking. is shaking, like especially Dominic, and I just compliment him and told him that we can do this. Trust us.
How?
We're the world champion. Just trust us and we will win this.
Okay. So that's like what we call name buff, right? Like you have a buff, title buff.
It's called name buff.
but their attitude is good, especially Ol and Dominic. So we were synced just in 2 weeks because they are a good person.
That's very interesting because I think like Backlist is going to be really strong, especially in season 10, right? You guys have the 2 good XP laners, 2 good goal laners, and then right now you're going to have 2 junglers, 2 roamers, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, like, I think Backlist looks good for like at least like the next couple of years. You guys have a ton of talent over there. But I'm really curious. So, like from the applications itself, how many people actually applied?
From my Facebook page, I think more than 200 players applied, even because I already posted the stats that I want. For example, I wanted an 80% above win rate of their main accounts. I wanted this kind of percentage for the heroes they used. But there are still players who submitted even if it's not the one I'm looking for. So every time I have to check one by one, I really check those messages until I reach Dom. It was not easy, but it was worth it.
I kind of understand, because like we did the same thing. We asked for like certain win rates, you know, certain rankings, and then we get like people epic warrior and stuff just applying, just messing shit up for us. We have to go through like stupid lists.
Yeah.
I remember, like, I think the first time we did it after we won M1, we did that. I think we got like almost like 10,000 applications, and then like 70% were just stupid. Hey, I just want to join EVOS. I don't know what is my rank. Some stupid shit make us like filter through all that. So, yeah, I understand. Yeah, but that's really interesting to see how a team could work out in just 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Would you say that's pure skill, or you know, that's probably some luck?
Both.
A little bit of both.
All right. So there's another question here. This is for Wise. So let's say if you had to play in MPL, but the support isn't Venus, would you still play?
Depends on her
decision.
What? Why me?
I need my captain decision in real life.
So actually there was a time that before we go to blacklist, there was a time that one team is looking to buy out Wise without me, and I was like, yo, no, you go for it. I think you can do it, because I actually believe that Wise can still play, and I think he is really a good player even without me.
Yes, I remember that, because after our loss in season 6 and then Onyx PH kick us,
they kick you guys. Kick? Was it really kick?
I think so.
when Onyx removed us, we don't really have a choice. There was no one in MPLPH that wants us to.
Yeah.
So it's just either my Venus or Wise. So only one team decided to get us both, which is Blacklist International. So I'm very thankful for Blacklist, because they get us both, and they, I mean, ang tawag dun? Nagtiwala. They trusted us. Blacklist International trusted us.
Looks like Blacklist, you know, everything paid off.
Yeah.
Are you able to tell us, like, what was the team that wanted to buy you out? Like, the one that only just wanted Wise?
It was Signal Ultra.
Oh, that was in season...
Season 7.
Yeah, season 7.
Incoming season 7.
Signal Ultra became a TNC, was it? Or...
I'm not really sure.
I think Signal Ultra disbanded after season 7.
Okay. And then, okay, that's cool. Actually, so Blacklist, was the person who approached you guys, was it Bond?
It's actually the CEO of Blacklist, which is Strike.
Boss Strike. So he approached you guys directly.
Yeah. Yes.
Oh, that's very interesting for a CEO to approach a player straight right away. That shows a lot of respect, because you know, I think like for CEOs, most of them are more into like the business aspect. They wouldn't really go and try to understand the player's hands on, you know. But I mean, respect, man, to Strike who did that.
Yeah, Actually, Buzzrek is a gamer before. Yeah, he was a shoutcaster in Dota. Yeah. So he really understands. Actually, he really helped us a lot during M3. Yeah, strat-wise, he really gave a lot of useful opinions, useful strategies, even on MPL Season 7 and Season 8. Yeah, that is our CEO.
So CEO is part-time, right? So full-time CEO, part-time coach here.
You can see that.
That's interesting. I think our CEO has to step up, you know. If not, probably have to find a new CEO. Cool. I've never heard of a CEO who helped with strats. That's really interesting.
Yeah, very unique.
You'll be surprised if Boss Strike will talk to you.
maybe Boss Strike can play. In professional sense.
how old is he?
I'm not really sure. I'm not sure of the age.
I think it's too old, man. You know, age matters. You know, when you're almost 30, you got to think of building a family and all. How are you going to commit, man?
Yeah, but, that's actually true.
What's your take on that? Like, do you think like you guys could still be pro players, you know, when you're like 30 and above, you know? Do you think you are still able to maintain at the same level or improve?
How old was Donkey when he won M1?
Donkey was, I think it was 31.
Yeah, 31. Yeah, I actually saw that fun fact.
He was actually my inspiration when Omay Binos is saying, I'm already old. and then I will say, oh, why Donkey is a world champion when he was at age, because I remember playing M1, Donkey is, I want to kick Donkey because he is shouting, Lunox, go shot of your fight, Lunox, go your fight. Donkey is, I think, he is a joyous person and is a shot caller in the game. Because I really remember that time when we faced Ebos in group stage. And
I remember that.
It's like face-to-face. Yeah. And I remember Donkey is always kicking me in using his chew.
Yeah, chew me. M1 was our first international tournament, and our first international opponent was actually Evo. So it was our first time experiencing facing against Indonesia. So we were shocked at how they played offline, like with all the shouts, with all the hype. It was really new to us. So we were shocked during M1 that, you know, it's a very good experience.
I cannot forget this because I was using Harit, which is my favorite hero, when I was mage user. And then my hands were literally shaking. My hands were shaking because I got scared of Ebos because they look so strong. And so they just look so strong in M1. So
So we can say Donkey is our inspiration. That doesn't matter.
Okay. Yeah, because Omay Binos is always saying, I'm already old enough, I should retire.
No, I'm not saying that. I can still play. I'm confident.
How old are you both right now?
I'm 27.
This year?
No. Yeah, 27, turning 28 this year.
All right, we're the same then.
Oh.
For me, I am 21 years old.
How old are you, MTV?
27 also, turning
28. So we're all like 94 kids.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. I mean, like, you know, I think age is relative, you know. I think it really depends on the individual itself, you know.
Yeah.
This is what I strongly believe, because like, I feel that right now we're still in an age where esports is still new. And we're kind of like maybe the first coming to second generation of players. So that's why you don't really see many older players who still compete in esports.
Yeah.
But I think over time, you know, you might even see like a 40-year-old esports pro player. But it really comes down to how much they want to commit and whether the industry or infrastructure can accept something like that. But I feel, yeah, age doesn't really affect skills that much. That's what I strongly believe, because you kind of can compensate it with experience, especially if you're playing like a support or role position.
So I agree.
So for MTV, so like,
yes.
Yeah. So we're talking about age, right? Do you think there's an age limit for coaches? You know, perhaps you might be too old, you know, coaching doesn't last long enough, or you might want to switch careers.
No, I think this is the second step after after becoming a pro. Usually pro players become coaches, because being a coach is really just about the how you think. It's not really about how good you play. So I think there's no limit or there's no age limit for being a coach, because we also see, especially in NBA, we see old coaches there. That's because they can still think and experience everything, right? So that's why I think there's, even in ML, there's no limit on how old a coach can be.
But what do you think about, like, so I understand like Bon is married and has kids, correct?
Yeah.
Does he still stay in like the gaming house with you guys, or does he like go back?
He still stays here in the gaming house.
So I think the biggest struggle for coaches and players is that when they start to really have families, how do they split their time, you know? Because most of the time, players and coaches have to be in a gaming house.
I'm not really sure about that. I don't know how coach handles it, but
yeah,
I think every day he's talking to his family, but so, I'm not really sure.
Yeah, but I think it's hard, like emotionally. Let's say your kid, your wife. Like I think it's very hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a hard thing to do, and I think like I feel like because, like I said, I think esports is still new. So like everyone expects us to, you know, live in a gaming house, you have to stay together and stuff. I think things might change, you know, when we start moving into the next decade or so, you know. Coaches, you know, might go back and forth, players might do it like it's an office job. But you know, I think we have to see how it goes from there.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, what do you think of like a team that does live in a gaming house versus a team that does not? Do you feel that it's a big advantage to whichever?
What do you think, MTV?
I came from amateur coaching, so I experience being in online coaching these kids. It's really different from what I see in Blacklist, because number one, communication wise, we don't know how these kids online, if you're just doing online, we don't know what they do while training. I also experienced a player that asked someone to just pilot his account and just didn't turn his mic on, just to practice. So being in an online practice will really affect the communications and the strategies that you wanted to pull off. Unlike if everyone is together in the gaming house, you will see how they react, you will see how they think, how they get comfortable in each other. So I think that's one of the keys. If you really want to build a strong team, you need to have the chemistry.
So you feel that living together is almost necessary, like it's a must.
Yeah, I think if you really want to aim higher, you really need to have your own gaming house.
All right.